thank you very much, and thank you again for hosting the symposium today and letting me present my project. This was actually my master's thesis that I did this year. So, as we all know, medical residents experience a significant amount of stress daily. Multitasking, dealing with sick patients, financial pressures of funding their education, and physicians and especially residents are at high risk of developing burnout, which is the triad of depersonalization, emotional exhaustion, and a decreased sense of personal accomplishment. Because of this, CanMeds, as Joanne alluded to earlier, is our kind of framework for our curriculum. They've now initiated wellness initiatives into the CanMeds curriculum, more so in the professional and leader domains. And one of the mechanisms for establishing wellness is through mentorship. And studies have shown, both for faculty and residents, that mentorship guides both personal and professional development. However, as much as the benefits are known, it's still inconsistent and not common within many residency programs. The literature shows, a Canadian residency survey showed that over 50% of residents did not identify as having a mentor, and within radiation oncology, Rishma Jags, he's done some work again showing that about 50% did not have mentors during residency, and rates were higher in females. So therefore, this kind of led me to my project. I took, in order to better understand the perceptions of mentorship according to the key stakeholders, which would be the potential mentees, our residents and mentors, the faculty, a qualitative exploratory study was performed to address the following research questions. What are the perceived mentorship experiences and needs of residents and faculty? And what are residents and faculty's perceptions regarding the formation of mentorship relationships? So this study was done within the University of Toronto's Department of Radiation Oncology, including the residents and faculty members. And I should say that we currently do not have a formalized mentorship program for our residents. So this was purely a needs assessment. Data, this was a qualitative study, so I did one-on-one semi-structured interviews with both residents and faculty who volunteered. All interviews were audio taped and transcribed verbatim afterwards, and data collection was done until saturation or when there was no new themes or ideas brought forward by the residents and faculty. Data was analyzed through an inductive thematic analysis that was done by myself and a second independent researcher who was a collaborator on the project. We went through and read all the transcriptions and made a list of key codes that were then categorized. We then discussed the codes amongst the two of us and any discrepancies that we found. We discussed again until we reached a consensus. And from that list of key codes, we interpreted them to yield some final emerging themes. And so 20 interviews were done back in the fall from October until December. So there are 22 residents within UTDRO and 10 volunteered to participate. So this was 64%. Or I should say 10 were interviewed. There were a bit more who volunteered, but we had reached that saturation. And for faculty within UTDRO, we have 61, and we did 10 faculty interviews. And as you can see, the ages, so there's a bit of a spread within the ages of both the residents and the faculty. Obviously, faculty are older. There was well balanced between sex and seniority, so almost equal male and female, and almost equal junior and senior. So junior residents were PGY 1, 2, 3, senior residents PGY 4 and 5. We define junior faculty just arbitrarily as faculty on staff for less than 10 years, and more senior faculty is greater than 10 years. And so there were four themes that were eventually identified, and I'm going to go through one by one. So the first theme, I called it mentorship experiences, faculty and resident interpretation of interactions. So I won't be able to go through all of the results in full, but just one of the things that really struck me was all the residents identified as having relationships and good, helpful relationships with faculty. But the vast majority said, yeah, but I don't view them as mentors, or this is not really mentorship. I get some advice, but that's it. And faculty, though, said, oh yeah, I'm a mentor to my residents. It's not formalized, but I'm definitely a mentor. And the reason the residents, for the discordance, they viewed it as guidance and advice, but residents really didn't see it as a longitudinal relationship or a consistent relationship as having that person. They kind of had multiple people that they had brief interactions with. And so one of the faculty said, I consider myself as a mentor to quite a number of people. It's not a formal relationship or label, but I think it's definitely in the spirit of mentorship. For example, I have a lot of people come to me for advice. I look out for them and try to give them opportunities. I'm sometimes surprised when residents say, I don't have a mentor because I think I have mentored you. So just showing the discordance between residents and faculty. The second theme was mentorship needs of residents and faculty, navigation and evolution. Both residents and faculty described and placed way more emphasis on the need for professional guidance rather than personal guidance. Some people didn't even mention wanting personal guidance from, some of the residents never mentioned wanting personal guidance from faculty. They didn't feel that they wanted to cross that boundary or they could ask that question. But they really just wanted professional guidance. You know, how do I do research? How do I get a fellowship? How do I get a job? And the other thing that was brought up was a lot of residents described as they go throughout residency, they really noticed their mentorship needs change. A lot of the juniors said, I need help in just understanding what do I do as a RADOM resident? How do I understand the program? What are the logistics? How do I do some research? The senior residents really wanted more focused and specific advice. How do I network with this person at this other institution? How can I get a fellowship? How can I eventually get a job? And so what I kind of based from this was that, you know, having just a one mentor is probably not best. It's not a one size fits all. A resident should really have access to multiple mentors, but diverse mentors. Maybe someone for research, maybe someone for professional guidance, maybe someone more for work-life balance. And one of the residents said, often I think we want to know certain things and maybe we don't have the courage to ask. This is not really about jobs so much as more personal topics. So this whole issue of residents not wanting to be perceived as weak, not having the courage to kind of say, I need some help, how do I do work-life balance, I want to have a family. They didn't really feel like they could cross that line with some people. Thirdly, mentorship relationships, do's and don'ts. So some of the do's that kind of came out in how to make relationships and make successful relationships was be committed, and both people, faculty and residents, really need to be engaged and committed and want to do it. You can't just say, here you go, do it, if you're not committed. Residents should have the ability to select a mentor, but there should be some guidance, whether it's from the program director or some other faculty, because some of the junior residents especially, they don't know who to ask, they don't know. So there's maybe being able to have some bios to read or knowing a bit more about faculty to help them find a mentor. And there should actually be, residents and faculty both thought there should be some structure and some kind of formalized program to ensure that it actually happened. But the big thing was they didn't want to see relationships being forced upon them or just mandated, and they didn't want it to be too rigid. There should be flexibility to have more than one mentor, move around, allow peer mentorship, etc. So one of the faculty said, I don't think you can force these relationships. Certainly the best mentor-mentee relationships I've had, whether I was a mentee or a mentor, have really been that kind of gelled intrinsically. I think chemistry is really hard to quantitate. I think that engagement has to be evaluated by both parties. And lastly, the term peer mentorship came up a lot. So I call this one peer mentorship, the good, the bad, the ugly, because really three main things came up. The good was within UTDRO, there is this culture of residents giving and receiving advice amongst each other. But again, they didn't call it mentorship, they called it friendship. The bad was they sometimes felt that they were the blind leading the blind and propagating misinformation because they didn't really know. You know, they think, oh, there's no jobs here, but they don't know that. They hear gossip and it gets propagated. And the ugly was sometimes this sense of competition. University of Toronto is a big academic, department, and they brought up some issues of competition and jealousy for, say, research and jobs, especially within the Canadian job market now, it is quite limited, so there's not that many opportunities. So in conclusion, in this qualitative study, the views of mentorship were explored for the two key stakeholders, the residents and the faculty. Important insights were generated regarding perceived experiences, needs, and how to actually create these relationships. And there were some alignments, but also discordances that must be acknowledged and addressed before we actually go out and implement such a program. So my next step is going to be creating, implementing, and then evaluating some sort of formalized program based on what the faculty and residents want. And then I hope to be able to collaborate with other programs, whether other, you know, use our results to inform other programs looking to start mentorship programs within RADONC or, you know, just internal medicine, both within Canada and outside. And so my supervisors, I did my master's through Maastricht University in the Netherlands, so Sylvia Henneman, and Meredith was my local on-site collaborator, and Emily helped me do all the data analysis and coding. And then lastly, I wouldn't be able to do it without the residents and faculty. So thank you very much.